My name is Eric Liu, and I am the executive director of the Aspen Institute's program on citizenship and American identity. And on behalf of the Aspen Institute, I just wanted to welcome all of you here this afternoon. I know there are some of you here who are regular and frequent flyers here at Aspen, and some of you as well who are perhaps with us for the first time. And so I just wanted to say a brief word about this institution. It is a unique creature in the ecosystem of ideas in Washington and beyond, partly because it is really an institution that really tries to bridge between ideas and action across a wide variety of domains and subject matter fields. The program that I run on citizenship and American identity is a relatively new program launched just late last year. And we're doing a variety of projects that are really trying to unpack the very simple question here in the United States in the 21st century, which is, who is us? How do we define a sense of common nationhood? How do we define or redefine American here in 2015? And so today's program is really completely in the spirit of that inquiry. We're just delighted to have a really fantastic group of speakers here today, and delighted to have this really wonderful cross-sectoral and diverse group of participants and attendees here. And our aim, after we get some time on stage, is to really open it up into a wider conversation. So without further ado, let me introduce the moderator for today's event, my friend Michael Tomasky, who's the editor of Democracy Journal. All of you, I believe, on your seats have a copy of the most recent issue of Democracy. Those of you who are not familiar with Democracy, I hope will become eagerly and readily familiar with it. It is one of the great journals in the country for exploring ideas and the future of progressive ideas in our politics. Mike is not just a great journalist, but a great friend, and really grateful to you, Mike, for moderating today. So I'll turn it over to you.
Thanks. Thank you. Hi, everybody. Thanks for the nice words about the journal, Eric, so I don't have to do my plug. I can save us those 30 seconds. I found it interesting. I heard on the radio this morning, not just the radio. Speaking of common cultural touchstones, I have a feeling that in a room like this, NPR and Garrison Keillor don't have to be explained to anybody. So Garrison Keillor's little five-minute segment this morning on NPR, he noted that it was Daniel Webster's birthday today. Now, Daniel Webster is a guy who did a lot to give the United States a common cultural literacy and a common literacy, and he dropped the U out of words like color and flavor. That was him. I bet you didn't expect to learn that today. this is great, and it's just great to see and meet Don Hirsch, who has been such an important contributor to on this topic, on education in America, for so many years, and a misunderstood man back in the 1980s, which we'll also touch on. I want to just stop yammering and get started. We're going to let Eric speak first, then Don, then Alyssa Rosenberg. So I'm just going to take a second, and I don't like to be seen up on these stages with glasses, but it's unavoidable. Eric Liu is the executive director of the Aspen Institute Citizenship and American Identity Program and founder and CEO of Citizen University, which is this great thing that he runs in Seattle. I've been to one of his weekends, and convenes, what, it must have been 200 people at the time that I was there, maybe 300, and they talk about civic participation and civic leadership, and at the very end, the culminating event, they even swear in new citizens of the United States. it's a lovely event, and Eric's also written a number of books, co-written some with our friend Nick Hanauer, The True Patriot and the Gardens of Democracy, The Accidental Asian, a New York Times notable book, and his most recent, A Chinaman's Chance. So everybody is going to talk for, I'll introduce the others in their turn. Everybody's going to talk for 5 to 7 minutes. I'll give you a little sign if I feel you're violating that. But Eric, why don't you tell folks what inspired you to write the piece for Democracy Journal, which, by the way, is one of the most widely read, I think, in the history of our site. Before I do that, I just need to say two thank yous that I just remembered. To your man, Ben Phillips, who helped do many of the logistics to arrange this event, and to my co-editors, my colleagues at Democracy, Albert Ventura and Jack Meserve. Albert is there, Jack is back in the corner. They're editors, they're really smart guys, but they also have to do things like bring our sign here and set out lunch and stuff like that. So thanks, Albert and Jack. And with that, now, please, Eric, Lou, take it.
Well, thanks, Mike. And I just want to say, by way of context here, the conversation we're having this afternoon is one that was catalyzed by Don Hirsch, and one that I think is really pertinent to the way that every one of us lives and moves in American life. To me, we're in a moment right now of such sweeping demographic change. And that's not just a matter of the statistics that say that sometime in a couple of decades, a majority of Americans will be people of color. That actual threshold has already been passed among new babies born in the United States in 2014 and 2015. It's not just about the statistics of that demography. It's about the underlying tectonic shifts in culture. And one simple way to describe this that I do in the piece that I wrote for Democracy on this topic is simply to say that for the first time in our country's history, the idea of Americanness and the idea of whiteness are beginning to delink. And that delinkage is creating all kinds of excitement and opportunity and fear and turbulence that we see in our popular culture, that we see in our presidential politics, and that we feel in different aspects of everyday life. That is a central tectonic shift, that delinkage. And it's not just, a notable, interesting demographic fact. It starts to raise a deeper question that if this implicit linkage that has been present from the very creation of this country between Americanness and whiteness, that whiteness is the norm, and that these two things are synonymous, if that linkage begins to break, then it begs the larger question, how shall we define or redefine Americanness at this point? What will be then the more inclusive, truly diverse content of the culture of this country? And that question really of how we define American is one that is a central driving question in all the work that I do. But it's also been a question that in many ways is at the heart of the work that Don Hirsch has done over a career. The inspiration for the piece that I wrote in Democracy, which is in this issue that all of you have gotten here, was a book that Don wrote back in 1987. Many of you are familiar with it already. The book was called Cultural Literacy. And I don't know, 85, 90% of the book is this very textured, thorough, well-reasoned, interesting argument about the nature of what Don calls background knowledge, schema, patterns of background knowledge that anybody needs to begin to attain in order to gain fluency, much less mastery, of a culture. Now, that's true for any fractal scale, right? If you are, like me, a baseball fanatic and following the postseason right now, there's a whole set of cultural references, a whole set of language and terms, a whole set of historical references that you need to understand when people start talking baseball, when people start talking about the playoffs and about the historic nature of what's going on this postseason. And if you don't, you find yourself feeling a little bit illiterate, you find yourself feeling a little bit on the outside of that circle. It's true at every fractal scale from there, from a particular professional community to the place of a city, to a community of interest, whether identity interest or belief interest, to a community of the scale of a country. And as I say, 85, 90% of this book was a textured argument about the importance of both gaining and teaching these notions, these patterns and schema of background knowledge. But the last 10, 15% of the book is what ended up being the tail that wagged the dog of this book's fame. And it's an appendix of 5,000 essential names, phrases, dates, and concepts that Don and a couple of his colleagues felt that every American should know. And this list of 5,000 made this book a sensation back in the late 1980s. And it kicked up this storm, which was already part of the emerging culture wars in the United States, about, well, how do we define American? Right? Here was a proposition that one way to define American is you got to be fluent in these 5,000 things on this list. At the time, because of the polarizing nature of the culture war, this book and this list got lumped into the side of conservatives and reactionaries. The list was attacked and criticized by many as being inherently retrograde, as being Eurocentric, as being perhaps even racist and sexist because it had an overweening emphasis on the, quote, dead white men of American history and American life. And those who got caught up in making that case against this book were, in my view, profoundly wrong. And what I argued in the piece that you'll see in Democracy is that it is long past time here, now that we're well into the 21st century and facing the diversity and change and flux in our demography that I described at the outset, it is well past time for us to revisit this idea of cultural literacy and to recognize that on a fundamental level, Don Hirsch was right in 1987. In fact, the more diverse this country becomes, the more that technology and other forces make us make it easier for us to fragment into small pieces, make it easier for us for birds of a certain feather to flock together and never to encounter Americans of another feather, the more necessary it becomes for us to have a common vocabulary, a common set of cultural and historical references that we can all share and understand roughly so that when we encounter one another, we understand each other and understand one another as part of a shared community. The thing that I argued in the piece, however, is that what we have to do is two things. Number one, update this list for the 21st century, for this diverse, more inclusive culture and society that we are in right now. And not only in terms of race and gender and religion and so forth, but actually in terms of the kind of highbrow, lowbrow, middlebrow conceptions of culture. That the list ought to contain not only the things that elites might think are important, but are important for any immigrant. I don't mean just an actual newcomer to the territory of the United States. I mean, say, a first in their family to go to college, or somebody moving from a rural environment to a city environment, or somebody moving from an ethnically homogeneous environment to an ethnically heterogeneous environment. Then any immigrant, any newcomer to a scene in 21st century America needs to have a far more inclusive and capacious notion of a list like this. And the second thing and final thing that I argued in this piece was that list, if we're to reimagine it for the 21st century, can't just be about one or two or three smart people coming up with a long list. That we've got an opportunity now, thanks to technology, to make it our list, to crowdsource this thing in a way that a room like this or a community or a country can be invited to say, what do you think, what are the things that matter to you? What do you think every American should know? And indeed, at the end of the piece, we invited readers to submit not a list of 5,000, but to submit their top 10. And as we begin this conversation, I actually want to invite you in the backs of your minds to think about if you had to pick 10 things that you felt like every American ought to know about, references from history, catchphrases, ideas, whatever it might be, what might be on your list of 10? And as we extended that invitation in the pages of the magazine, we've received, I believe, upwards of 1,000 responses. And that led us to realize that we've got a larger project here. And we'll talk about that a little bit later, the larger project of reaching out to communities and citizens around the United States to invite them into this conversation and this co-creation of a new conception of a shared background knowledge, common American curriculum.
Great. Thank you, Eric. I have in my hand a list. That's a cultural touchstone. Remember that one? 30. We have the top 30 that we have crowdsourced, and we'll put this up on the screen here a little bit later. And as you ask your questions, I think we'll ask you to rattle off a few. We'll be interested in hearing what you have to say. E.D. Hirsch Jr. is the founder of the Core Knowledge Foundation and Professor Emeritus of Education and Humanities at the University of Virginia. He is the author, of course, as Eric just said, of the bestseller Cultural Literacy, but many other books, The Schools We Need and Why We Don't Have Them, The Knowledge Deficit, The Making of Americans. We're so pleased to have you here today. I wonder if you could use a portion of your opening time to talk about what it was like to be in the middle of that unexpected.
I'll be happy to. And yeah. First, I want to thank Eric for rehabilitating me. it was pretty astonishing to read a book that said an article saying cultural literacy is fundamentally right after having. What 30 years of people saying cultural literacy was wrong, and actually wicked, because it was sustaining an oppressive culture and not letting other cultures thrive. I want to take up before I give an anecdote or two about what it was like. I want to take up a point that Eric made at the end about what we should do to reconstitute a sense of the things that bring us together. And I have to think that there are two important enterprises, not just the reconstituting of what can bring us together or what should bring us together, but also the question of that you brought up at the end of considering everybody an immigrant who is sort of an outsider to the insider culture, the culture of power, the culture that can get things done in the United States. And that is a culture that everybody in this room clearly already belongs to. You wouldn't be in this room if that weren't the case. And suppose for a minute you considered all the words, including proper nouns, and proper names, that 70% of the people in this room knew. Okay, now we have that list of words. I'll come back to a minute why I think vocabulary is highly indicative. And then you say, let's decide what's all the words that 70% of people who make $20,000 a year or under, what is the vocabulary that they have and that they know? Okay, let's subtract that basis that everybody already knows from this group of words and knowledge that everybody here has in common. Well, I think the first order of business is to introduce these outsiders to that culture, if our aim is equal opportunity, and particularly if we find we can do that by changing the nature of the elementary school. The elementary school, the first 6 or 7 grades, preschool through grade 5 are the critical periods in schooling where that can happen. Suppose we can at least make that effort. That's one kind of effort that's a little different from culture change, because that's cultural transmission. And there is an existing culture. Despite the fact that we have to change American culture, there is this culture that we in this room share and that outsiders do not share. And I think that has to be a key aim of our schooling going forward. And in itself would help, I think, overcome some of the fragmentation that we see and some of the inequality that we see. But let me go back to the initial. When Core Knowledge came out it was spring of 87, was put out by Houghton Mifflin, and as an education book, they printed 10,000 copies to last over the lifetime of the book. And I was, it had a, they had a clever publisher at Houghton Mifflin named Billy Julia, and she got me a slot speaking to the education reporters who were gathered together that spring. Mm-hmm. In San Francisco, it was. I still remember the event very clearly. I gave a short 10-minute chat about what it was, but the reporters had all seen advance copies and had. And the first question I got after I had made my little introductory remark was from the man from AP, a very powerful, obviously, position education reporter, since it goes out to all the newspapers. And he said, "Professor Hirsch, is Cinque de Mayo on your list?" Mm-hmm. And I said, "No." He said, "Well, don't you think it should be on your list?" And I said, "Probably." I was into this sort of theoretical argument, you know. I said, "Well, what do we all know?" And I guess a lot of us didn't know what Cinque de Mayo was. And then, but he set out, fast forward a little bit, the AP writer did describe what the book was saying and set it out all over the country. And by the time I got back from that event and in San Francisco, I had a letter from Delaware, a small town of Delaware, with a newspaper clipping in fold and said, "This is the front page of our newspaper. Professor Hirsch, I would like you to know that you have displaced the Iran-Contra controversy, and you have, and the gays in the military controversy, and they put you right on the front page. I'm sending you this because this will never happen to you again." And actually, and when I got back to the hotel from that incident, there was the telephone messages were, some kind of cord had been hit. But the message I particularly remember was I was to call back a TV station in Texas, and the question the TV station wanted to ask was, had I had indignant messages from all the celebrities who had been left off of the list? And so I saw this was something that was sort of taking over, and what the book said and what the aim was going to have nothing, very little to do with the reception of the book. Yeah. So that's my little anecdote, but and you know, things went in all sorts of directions. One other little comment about what happened was that I would get these letters from grateful school teachers said, "Yes, this is what we need," in the mail, and I would get hate articles in the journals about how terrible this was. So there was always a kind of bifurcation in the reaction to the book. Anyway, that's enough by way of anecdote.
Yeah, no, well, and it, you know, it lives on. So you know, unbalanced, it's been all good. Alyssa Rosenberg here blogs about pop culture for the Washington Post's opinions section. Before coming to the Post, she was culture editor of Think Progress, the television columnist at Women in Hollywood, a columnist for the Double X Factor at Slate, and a correspondent for TheAtlantic.com. And despite her seemingly youthful appearance, she's been at this for a long, long time, because she was just telling us over lunch that she wrote her first review at the age of 8.
We had the children's section of a local newspaper that was very desperate for content and was willing to take a columnist who would be paid in $5 gift certificates to the local bookstore. It was a fabulous racket.
That's more than a lot of places are paying.
Yeah, journalism has come full circle now.
That's true. It's true. Things have really come down. I'm here today both as a beneficiary of Professor Hirsch's book, which I read for the first time in 9th grade, so more than half my life ago, and I think benefited from teachers who had really absorbed the principles of the book. I'm also here as someone who's coming from a slightly different perspective, because we have experienced enormous cultural fragmentation in the years since cultural literacy was published. And I remember you noting that perhaps the only mass culture Americans had left was television, and I thought it was useful for this discussion to just demonstrate how that mass culture doesn't exist anymore to a certain extent. So I hope you'll forgive me some statistics. The year that cultural literacy was published, the most watched television show in the United States was The Cosby Show, and 30.5 million households tuned in on average for every episode of that show. And that's more than 30 million people, since multiple people were watching per household. Now, far and away, the top-rated television program in the United States is Sunday Night Football. Any other scripted programming, something like Empire that cracks 17 million viewers, is having unprecedented success. So,
by the way, how many more millions people live here now?
50 million.
Exactly. Yeah, right. And that cultural fragmentation is apparent in cable television and broadcast television. In 1999, cable TV broadcast just 23 original scripted series. In 2014, that number was up to 180. If you add the broadcast and streaming outlets in, there were 328 original scripted shows on the air in 2014. And that doesn't count news programming, reality programming, sports programming, or anything that's imported and airs on PBS. So no, none of your British costume dramas, Downton Abbey, doesn't count. And this is true across media. According to the Motion Picture Association of America, there were 489 theatrical films released in 2004, a number that had risen 35% to 659 in 2013. Traditional book publishing has held fairly steady over the past couple of years. Around 300,000 books were released in 2013, but there's been a huge explosion in self-publishing. That same year, people self-published more than 458,000 books. If you're a critic like me, that's a lot to keep up with, especially since some of those self-published books are turning into Hollywood blockbusters. The Martian, which came close to breaking records when it was released a couple weeks ago, started out as a self-published venture on scientist Andy Weir's blog. And this doesn't even touch on other forms of self-publishing and self-distribution, whether you've got YouTube stars, you have people who are live streaming through Periscope, Vine, things like Snapchat. So the sheer amount of media out there is astonishing. And to add a counterpoint to the discussion before we begin, there are some real benefits to this cultural fragmentation. If you are a woman or a person of color, the declining TV ratings have opened up enormous new opportunities for people like Issa Rae, who just got a series order for a new show from HBO, or Lena Dunham, to create shows that have smaller but newly sustainable audiences and that represent people who were previously dramatically excluded from a mass medium like television. If you look at the history of American television, the times that African Americans have been represented on screen have been times of cultural fragmentation when the business was struggling. Mm. You look at the 1970s when you have the sort of explosion of the broadcast model, then you have shows like Sanford and Sons. If you look at the 1990s when you have new shows like UPN and new networks like UPN and the WB, you have an explosion of shows like Living Single, like Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. And now with the decline of conventional television ratings, you see shows like Empire, Blackish, and Terrific Fresh Off the Boat. So as much as I agree with Professor Hirsch about the value of a common culture, the fragmentation of American mass culture has created enormous opportunities to broaden the number and sorts of voices who are able to tell their stories in mass media at all. And so I don't think that this is necessarily a challenge to the idea that we should all have broad cultural literacy. It is, however, a challenge in making up the lists of what everyone should be literate in.
Okay. Mike, can I just jump right
please,
in here?
Please,
I think this is, we couldn't have planned this better, and we didn't actually plan this, but the fusion actually between a point that that Don Hirsch made and that Alyssa has made here is really important to note. When you're talking about the ways in which it is important, the phrase that you used, culture of power, mm-hmm. right? That there is a culture of power, that people in this room are sort of by definition fluent in a culture of power, and that part of the aim of this project from the very beginning was progressive in the sense that it wanted to fold more people into a, quote, culture of power, right? That is true. And I think that is a valid and a worthy goal. At the same time, what Alyssa is saying here is super important, that it's not just that there is a static thing
here called the culture of power. And we want to encourage more people who are outsiders, whether they are women, whether they are people of color, whether they are young people, whatever they might be, to come on in and join this culture of power and kind of learn the fixed static terms of the culture of power. Part of what Alyssa's describing is that as media and culture become more democratized, the culture of power itself is changing. The thing that is up here that people need to join in order to have common fluency in American life is itself mutating, right? And so when Alyssa talks about a show that is doing well now in this age of media fragmentation, Fresh Off the Boat, right? That is a show that maybe some of you have seen or heard of that is based on, it's a show, it's the first primetime television show to feature an Asian American family in 21 years.
And I should note that it's the second ever, which tells you something about how supposedly diverse and democratized American mass culture is. I mean, two in 20 years is not saying very much.
Right, exactly. And, but it's based on a memoir by the celebrity restaurateur Eddie Huang. And the title of the book was meant to be provocative because that phrase itself, fresh off the boat, among Asian American immigrants and many immigrant communities, has long been understood to be a bit of an epithet, an insult, right? That guy's so fresh off the boat, meaning crude, unschooled, illiterate in the culture of power, right? And Eddie, in his very brash and iconoclastic way, grabbed hold of that phrase and flipped it and said, I'm proudly fresh off the boat, right? My immigrant family was fresh off the boat, and it's very fun and interesting to look at all of the culture clashes involved in our acculturation. And it wasn't just that my immigrant family learned how to, quote, you know, act like mainstream white Americans. It was that as we did that, we changed the mainstream. We changed it enough so that now people can say the phrase fresh off the boat with a sense of humor, with a sense of irony, right? And now when you have a phrase like that baked into a show like that, that is in a that is a highly rated television show now in a mass culture, what's happened is that the culture of power has changed, right? And so there is this is not unidirectional, I guess is the simplest way to put it. Yeah. This is a feedback loop continuously of how we're changing one another.
Yeah. Great. We're going to continue to talk about all these things, obviously, but I want to ask Don a couple of questions about the book. The book, if you have not read it, it's basically an education, as he said, it's an education book. It's a book proposing a certain set of education reforms and principles for education reform. So I'd like to ask you, education reform is, you may have noticed, still being discussed today and still going on and something of a hot potato in the presidential campaign, at least on the Republican side, the core curriculum and so on. So. I'd like you to talk about what you see in the education reform world today and how you size all that up. But first, I'd like you to start out by answering this question. Did you have, aside from an educational pedagogical purpose, did you have any kind of polemical political purpose in writing the book?
Well, it all depends on if you call intellectual politics political. Mm-hmm. Certainly, the aim was to criticize and discredit the basic developmental theories of education that were dominant and are still dominant in the ed schools. So there was, and this book I wrote after Cultural Literacy, called "The Schools We Need," was an attack on that thought world, and there was an implicit attack on that thought world saying we have to change our ideas fundamentally, and that idea change is the most fundamental educational change that we could experience, because there are many deficiencies, intellectual and scientific deficiencies, in the dominant ideas in the schools today. That was that political, to the extent that you call us the university kind of fights mm-hmm. political.
Yeah. Yes.
that was certainly a political aim. But your other aim was, did I have any? Yes, I mean, there was the social justice aim, sure. which was behind cultural literacy, which mm-hmm. was, of course, strongly political. That is, there are a bunch of people that the educational system is keeping unempowered, that needs to be empowered with equal opportunity. And these ideas, with the best of intentions, are depressing equal opportunity in American education. So yes, there's a political purpose here in equalizing opportunity.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Contemporary education reform debate?
Well, everybody's pretty discouraged, I think, right now about the status of education reform. And I've a private theory that that's why there's so much teacher bashing now. Mm-hmm. The various education reforms have changed. It can't be the fault of my ideas, my reform ideas. It's got to be the fault of those teachers.
It's always the implementation.
Who are implementing it. But yeah, What was your actual question?
About the Common Core curriculum and other of these big education debates that are ongoing today.
Well, I feel that most of them could be solved if it were decided, if somebody had the courage, even in a single school district, to have a well-defined, coherent, grade-by-grade knowledge-based curriculum, mm-hmm. instead of the current skill prep that is going on now in the schools. If a single district did that, I think it would. Mm. I think that's what's needed, and you could do that. You could make a good curriculum district. But I think the district is the important education reform unit, because if you just do it in a single school, people say, well, it was the good teachers and so on. But if you do it district-wide and the district then flourishes, which is what would happen, then that would make an impression. But the other thing that's important in making a reform like that district-wide is that the poorest kids are the ones who change school the most often. And there's something like a 30% mobility rate in these large school districts. So you have to have a common curriculum so that their education isn't totally disrupted when they go from one school to another. Mm-hmm. So I do think somewhere there needs to be a district that will put a coherent knowledge-based curriculum in place from preschool through sixth grade or wherever. Mm-hmm. I think that would be the reform I would recommend, because you could do it under intellectual guys are saying this is Common Core or this is whatever you want to call it. Mm-hmm. But that's the thing that's needed, it seems.
I see. Did you want to get in?
No.
Oh, okay. I have a couple of questions. Well, I could come up with many, but I'll try to share my time with you good folks. But let me start with this question, and I'll start with Alyssa, and then we'll go down the row. So are you having trouble hearing?
Let me lift this up a little bit. We do this on TV sometimes too. I remember the storm around your book, the start of the culture wars, the first time we ever heard, hey, hey, ho, ho, Western culture's got to go, and all that stuff. I was a young person in those days. The complaint of the cultural left was basically the what we might call the guardians of culture.
Am I representing the cultural left here? Is that what's going on?
Maybe you're representing the guardians of culture. It depends on what you say.
It all comes down to this.
No, you're representing Alyssa Rosenberg. Don't worry. But the complaint was that the guardians of culture were resistant to any change and were reflexively attached to the canon and so on and so forth. Now, has that changed? How much has that changed? That certainly has changed in the last 30 years. But is there still even this thing called the guardians of culture? And how is it different than it was 30 years ago, such that cultural literacy can have the space to change?
Just as a disclaimer, I was one 30 years ago, so I don't want to claim to speak for the Academy as a whole. You know, I think that part of the reason that we see such sharp conflicts over, you know, maintaining some sense of the canon and bringing in new voices and new disciplines is because the canon has had a monopoly for a lot of years. There is, you know, if you look at Yale, the alma mater of a couple of us on this panel, you know, you can go in and take your freshman year and have the curriculum entirely be in the Western canon, and that option is just available for you. That's preset. And so I think that some of the resistance on the cultural left is just, it's frustration. It's about getting opportunities. Cultural criticism is a complicated place right now, as some of you may have noticed. And so I do think that we see, to a certain extent, an overreaction against the idea of the canon or against stories that are all about white men. I mean, to take a recent example, the Coen brothers' upcoming film, Hail Caesar, which is about Hollywood in the 50s, is under attack for being white and male, which, frankly, Hollywood was astonishingly white male in the 1950s for reasons that have to do with production code and who had power in studios. And so trying to come to some balance on the cultural left where we acknowledge that there are valuable works of art that were created by white men, that there are valid stories to be told about older white men. I, as a cultural critic who works from the left, I have no quibble with any of those things. But I do understand the frustration of people who have not seen themselves represented in mass culture, who have been told for decades and sometimes even centuries that their stories don't rise to the level of literature, or their history doesn't rise to the level of serious scrutiny. And so I think that these debates are a reflection of frustration over progress. And to a certain extent, they are not actual debates about the merits of the canon. They're debates about historical rigidity of people who perhaps didn't believe that the canons could stand up to competition. And look, I, as someone who has 5 copies of Paradise Lost in my apartment, you know, I love the canon. I might even be fairly accused of being overly attached to parts of the canon. But having been exposed to different academic disciplines, to, you know, reading Chinua Achebe doesn't make me love John Milton any less. Right. And in fact, you know, I think makes me love them both more. And so trying to take a multidisciplinary approach to the canon and suggest that a broader approach can only sort of strengthen some of the great works that we love might be a point of compromise, but I think we're a long way in certainly cultural and academic discourse from getting there right now.
Mike, I think part of what's implied in your question about the canon is even as we work to diversify any notion of a canon, cultural canon, literary canon, pop cultural canon, you know, the question arises of what do we hold on to, right? I agree with Alyssa's point that it is not a zero-sum sort of thing, that adding Fresh Off the Boat does not make you forget that Seinfeld existed, right? Does not make you forget that MASH existed. And reading Toni Morrison does not make you forget, you know, that forget the Iliad, right? The only book I have, the only document I have 5 copies of in my house, actually, is the Constitution of the United States. And if you think about the Constitution, you know, a work by dead white men, some of whom owned non-white men and women. And on a certain strict basis, you can say there's something just inherently repugnant about, you know, that document. And, anybody who has that instinct, I would say, is so profoundly wrong about the American enterprise as to be almost dangerous. The Constitution, though created by a certain class of dead white men who were deeply, not just flawed, but profoundly hypocritical, is a document that now holds us to a charge that says, how do we actually live up to this, right? How do we actually give that document life beyond the hypocrisy that was part of its birthing? And, you know, there are 2 things, one quite in mass political culture today, and one that's known particularly to those of us who went to Yale College, but it's of relevance here in a wider way. The one that's important for mass culture is Black Lives Matter, right? The debate, those of you who watched the presidential debate the other day saw how they were all given the question, you know, which has been formulated in this very reductionist, again, zero-sum binary way, is it Black Lives Matter or is it All Lives Matter, right? And
This is, of course, a larger debate in the United States, but I would submit to you that those who, for reasons of, you know, seeming wanting to have a capacious universalist sense of human dignity, who have the instinct to say, well, of course it's all lives matter, right, are profoundly historically illiterate, are profoundly illiterate in the constitutional, civic, and historical reasons why, in this country, it is necessary, even in 2015, to remind the country that black lives matter, right? It is not as if we exist today in 2015 at a baseline where all lives as a matter of law, as a matter of educational opportunity, as a matter of economic opportunity, are indeed equal, and so to emphasize one group over the other is somehow unfair. It's quite the opposite, right? And that historical illiteracy that is embedded in the debate around whether Black Lives Matter as a hashtag in a movement is somehow quote-unquote racist or reverse racist is a case in point about the dangers of not having a common cultural vocabulary, not having a common sense of how we even came to Black Lives Matter, right? And I think that is one of these, we're in one of these moments right now where this is not just a matter of it would be nice to be fluent in certain things to get certain references, but it's fundamental to whether we're going to be able as a country and a citizenry to live up to some of the ideas in our founding charter.
Could I jump in for just one moment? Because what you were saying there clarified something I've been thinking about in this discussion. A purity test for the canon is really boring, and almost nothing passes, right? If we are suggesting that authors or works in the canon have to meet a certain political standard to be included. A literacy standard, on the other hand, solves many of our political debates over the canon. If you need to have read a work or be familiar with a concept to understand other works, to understand other conversations, maybe that's a better test for whether a work belongs in the canon.
I'm so glad you made that distinction. I was going to point out that there has never been agreement about a literary canon in the United States in our history. The people who talked about the guardians of the canon were living in some sort of mythical world if they were talking about literary works, mm-hmm. or even our television shows or whatever. There was always debate about that and about what should be included. And I remember when cultural literacy was first reviewed, Luc Menand rather disdainfully said, this isn't a theory of great works, it's a theory of great words, he said. And what you just said about literacy, I think, and there was even a point in cultural literacy where I said, well, yeah, Cliff Notes is all right, because it is important that you know that Hamlet exists, and you know, because people talk about it, but yeah, you don't have to read it. And that really horrified a lot of people, because it was talking about literally a vocabulary. And you do have to know in general what the references of those words are in order to that we can have a conversation here like we're having. So I do think that that sort of disdainful, and you made that very good distinction too, that the canon is a canon, is a knowledge canon. It's a verbal canon. And that does exist, because that is almost an axiomatic point and a self-evident point, that if it turns out that you need background knowledge in order to understand words, then the reader or listener is contributing to meaning whenever a linguistic transaction is taking place, and you're bringing to bear a lot of unspoken understandings when language is going on. Yes, all the parties to that have to have that common background in order for the language transaction to take place. And so talking about a language canon or a knowledge canon makes, I think that was a very good intervention. Thank you.
I'm going to ask one last question. Well, okay, it's actually kind of two questions that I'm mashing together. and then it'll be your turn. So let's make this a little bit more political than it has been so far. you have, but you know, well, leave it to me to drag us down to the gutter. Does our current political polarization have an impact? What impact? Of course, it has an impact. What impact does it have on our search for common cultural literacy. Secondly, the conservative point of view is somewhat underrepresented on this stage. So let's represent it. What value do what do conservatives say about all this that's right, that has value? What do conservatives have to say about all this that is correct and that has value and that we should listen to?
I would put it a slightly different way, that the cultural left, and my friend Dick Rorty, late Dick Rorty, wrote a wonderful New York Times op-ed on this about our, calling it our unpatriotic academy, was the...
I remember it.
Do you remember that that op-ed that he wrote? It was a wonderful piece, and it was that the cultural left will find itself simply disdained if it remains unpatriotic, because Benedict Anderson wrote a wonderful book called Imagined Communities, in which he distinguishes nationalism from patriotism. And I think what the right has going for it is a sense, not the exclusive, that is, patriotism is the exclusive purview of white males, but or that kind of theme, but the theme that it's okay to be patriotic is something that the left needs to adopt as well as the right, because it's really a principle of communitarian. It's basically a communitarian principle. So I think that's what the one thing the conservatives can bring to the table is that orientation.
Eric co-wrote a book.
Well, yeah, one of my earlier books is called The True Patriot and makes quite that argument that that patriotism properly understood is not certainly not the province of one party or the other, but properly understood, it is about fidelity to a set of principles that it turns out are somewhat inherently progressive. Principles of inclusion, principles of equality, principles you know, that we've been talking about here, in just the same way that the enterprise of cultural literacy that Don started was inherently about a phrase that you used in passing earlier, about social justice. You know, trying to ensure that there is greater fluency in this common culture was an endeavor of social justice. And, you know, Mike, to your question about polarization. I think it is dangerous right now, and we see it every day in our politics, where partisans on both sides cannot even agree on facts, much less on interpretation of facts. And that is a consequence of the kinds of media echo chambers that we're much more able to produce today than, say, in 1987, where you can just have a self-enclosed bubble of worldview and what you consider to be facts about, pick your issue, about guns or climate or whatever it might be. And so that does make it more challenging, but it also makes it more urgent for us to be trying to do what we're doing here, right? I actually think in D.C. people have a heightened notion that all of America is so polarized and all of America is caught in these bubbles. But, you know, I'm from Seattle. And though Seattle is a monochromatically blue city, we are situated in an ideologically diverse state. And out in the rest of the country, people aren't necessarily stuck in those kinds of bubbles, right? People aren't thinking about it with such kinds of ideological purity tests about what their own fact base or canon should be. People are intermingling and hybridizing all the time. And, you know, this goes to your second question, Mike, about what do conservatives have right when they speak about cultural literacy and the rest. It's not only that there's a notion of true patriotism that conservatives sometimes speak about that I think progressives would do well to really unpack and not reflexively keep at arm's length, but it's also that, look, properly understood, the American enterprise is this great fusion of conservative and progressive. We are inherently conservative. But what we are trying to conserve is inherently progressive, you know. And so, you know, we in a country that has no ties of blood or faith, you know, to bind us together, all we have is the creed that is stated in that document that I have five copies of. But that's all. And so we are obsessed with trying to conserve some sort of fidelity to that and meaning to that. But in doing so, we are, by practice, and some of us in argument and theory as well, recognizing that that document is always driving us in more progressive directions, always trying to make sure that more people, in fact, do enjoy the privileges and immunities of citizenship in the United States. And I think that is that fusion of conserving and inherently progressive enterprise is something that I think is something that is core to the American project, and it's core to the cultural literacy effort, and it's core to the project that we're launching here in my program at Aspen to take to crowdsource and invite all of us and all of you into this effort to imagine a new list, imagine a new set of cultural references. And I hope before we break into open questions, we'll get a chance to show some of what people have come up with.
We will momentarily. It's Alyssa's turn to take a swing at this question. You thought you were going to dodge this? No.
No.
And then we're going to open it up. There's our microphone. Thank you very much. And as you ask your question, start thinking about now. And as you ask your question, name two or three things that you think should be on a modern 21st century list of American cultural literacy. And then a little bit later, Jack, a little bit later, we'll do the big reveal and put up on the screen what we got back from our little crowdsourcing experiment. So, Alyssa, conservatives, political polarization,
I actually see conservatives falling for a strain of thinking that has been more dominant on the left in recent years, which is that identity or ideology can be the litmus test for quality of a work. If you see things like the reaction to Mad Max Fury Road, the latest installment of the Mad Max franchise, or the rise of Gamergate in a conservative movement around the content of video gaming, these are, or something like the controversy over the Hugo Awards, these are conservative cultural advocates who are using the same sort of ideological and identity-based litmus tests for judging culture that some advocates on the left have been using a great deal more in the last 5 years. So I think that is a spreading strain of thinking that I would like to see eradicated from both sides, which I hope is sufficiently politic. In terms of the question of polarization, we've talked a lot today about how cultural literacy can help more people move up in and have access to these languages of power. I think one of the solutions to our current polarization could be for literacy to move in the opposite direction. As we become a majority-minority country, I think some of the polarization that we see right now is driven by anxiety about what it will be like to live in a country where the dominant language, the dominant tropes, the dominant cultural forms are not your own. That's an enormous transition for people to make. And so I wonder if greater cultural literacy about Latino folkways, about Asian customs, can help majority whites feel more comfortable in a new environment. And I think that cultural literacy is something that can flow in multiple directions and work in multiple ways, which is what makes it such a politically powerful concept, as well as such an important one educationally.
Great. All right, your turn. Can you, this gentleman? Say your name, please. And
My name is E. Ethelbert Miller. Mm-hmm. I'm with the Institute for Policy Studies. You have 5 copies of the Constitution. You have 5 copies of Paradise Lost. How many people have 5 copies of the Holy Quran in their house? I look at the word citizenship. We have people running for office, high office, and don't believe that a person could be a Muslim and be president of the United States. So I would just want to introduce the other R, religion, in this case.
I think we have, my husband and I have 2 copies of the Quran, 1 copy of the annotated, Hebrew Bible, and 3 or 4 copies of the Bible. So just as a library inventory. We have too many books is what I'm saying.
This is
a question that the United States is only beginning to reckon with. Western Europe, of course, is reckoning with it more directly and, frankly, poorly. But this, and so the Islamophobia of politics
certainly in Western Europe right now, is a cousin to what Alyssa was describing in terms of the anxiety of the status anxiety of a lot of white Americans. This sense that they're taking away my country, right? One of the a very controversial book in France right now that actually was published the day of the Charlie Hebdo massacre. A book called Submission, a novel that imagines a France in which something like the Muslim Brotherhood has actually taken power in France, right? And so it is a full-on articulation in an imagined world of all of the subterranean fears psychologically in France. We haven't had that quite so fully developed, but it's certainly coming out in our politics. And it comes out in a lot of other reflexive ways. And I think this is a signal example of what Alyssa was talking about. I think for non-Muslims to become more fluent in Islam here in the United States should just be a thing we do, right? Should just be a thing that we do to recognize the change in our country, our country's place in the world, and all of these other forces of migration and reckoning. Again, that doesn't mean it displaces anything else. It just means it's just a simple matter of responsibility to have that measure of familiarity, if not fluency.
If I could add one thought to that, though, studying a text obviously isn't the same thing as understanding all the myriad ways in which people will interpret it. And I would love to see much stronger sort of religious education programs, because you can read any number of holy books as literature, you can read them in historical context. I have no idea why a school would teach, the Crusades portion of history without having people read the books from all the major faith traditions. And so I find it a point of frustration that some of our principles about separation of church and state keep us from comparative religion being part of education very early.
Right. Curriculum. Yes. As with culture, I think curriculum ought to be as frequently used a word as culture, because everybody talks about what the schools should be doing. Indeed, the Core Knowledge Program has a pretty well articulated set of units on Islam, and children coming out of that such a school will know at least more than students coming out of other American schools know about Islam. But I do think we should keep it tethered to something we can do something about. The general terms about how we should change our culture. If we're going to change it in this way or this way or this way, it means you need to be activists for the elementary curriculum. The elementary curriculum is the key. Is the key to what you are able to do in late middle school and high school, and so if it's a mystery, and if the publishers are just turning it out in the form of textbooks, if it's something we are too scared to deal with, I think maybe that's a pretty important aspect of the whole discussion of culture, because it's the schools is the one TV or internet website or whatever that the kids are at for a certain number of hours every week, and it's sort of the idea of what did hold the country together when the initial reformers or makers of American education began. It was through the schools that they thought they would create it was the school that was to achieve that, and that's still the only real vehicle we have for achieving it.
This gentleman way over up here next to the window. Thank you.
This has been a very rich conversation. I've got so many thoughts. But to the point of education, my son is a fourth grade teacher, and it's much more complicated than we've talked about here, because he's saying, "Dad, it's so hard to teach these kids when they come to school hungry or they can't even speak English." So before we can even educate them, we have to get by those basic standards first, and it's quite a challenge. I was going to say something else, but the word patriotism came up. I've been grappling with this word for a long time. And it reminds me of a time during the Vietnam War when I was home from school as a college student and sitting down watching TV with my dad, who was a Bronze Star winner during the war under fire. And here I am, a college kid trying to avoid the draft. On television comes Walter Cronkite doing a news story about the war, I mean, the war protesting. And my father went into an instant rage and said, damn it, my country, right or wrong. And I said, Dad, I said, if your country asked you to jump off the Brooklyn Bridge, would you do it? I said, so I guess my question is, I think the thing that we really need to reinforce in our educational system is critical thinking. And I'd just like your impression on that.
You know, I appreciate your sharing that story and even that phrase that your father used, because any notion of what I've called true patriotism goes back to a line that was first uttered by a guy named Carl Schurz, who had been a general in the Union Army in the Civil War, a United States Senator from Illinois, was himself an immigrant from Germany. And during the debates in the late 1800s about nativism and patriotism and American identity, where that phrase first started getting used widely, my country, right or wrong, he gave a famous speech where he rebutted that. And he said, true patriotism is not my country, right or wrong. It's my country, when right to be kept right, when wrong to be set right. Right? And I've not found, actually, in all the writing and reading I've done, a better, crisper distillation of what real patriotism is. Right? That it is not blind obedience. It is not unthinking celebration. Nor is it merely reflexive criticism or expression of disenchantment or alienation. It is when right to be kept right, when wrong to be set right. Right? And all of that entails a measure of responsibility.
Okay. How about this gentleman, and then we'll go back to the other side.
A little earlier, you were talking about cultural literacy and how, you know, we have to kind of get everyone on the same page about, you know, what our cultural norms are, what our cultural, you know, what is acceptable, and you know, just a common core. My question is, how do we teach this while also acknowledging the privileges that are, you know, while acknowledging the privileges that, you know, are inherent between each ethnic groups? And how do we teach them to the people who have already given up on a system they feel have been, you know, have oppressed them and ignored them for so long?
Thank you.
Now, I didn't completely understand the question. Could you rephrase it, Mike?
Could I rephrase it?
Maybe let me take a stab at rephrasing it, you know, and maybe even speaking to it a bit. I think the question in part was, in a way, you know, when you speak about the obstacles of malnutrition or lack of English literacy that keep some kids from even ever entering into the game of attaining cultural literacy, you're talking about comparable barriers of a sense of cynicism that some people who are on the outside feel that the system has been so rigged against them, and they are so decidedly on the margins that why bother trying to attain fluency, in this quote-unquote language of power?
Well, that's a very real problem, of course, and our answer, to the extent that I've been engaged in educational reform, is to start a really coherent curriculum in preschool, so that the alienation isn't so deeply felt. I mean, if you do start very early to be inclusive and you're quite systematic about it, you don't feel so excluded. And that's been our experience. And that's certainly a way, theoretically, to make it work. And I think it works in practice, too. But one really, to do it, I come back again, you really do have to have a curriculum. You have to have worked it out and tried deliberately to accomplish just what you're talking about.
I saw a hand over there somewhere. Yeah, maybe it was yours.
Thank you. First, I have been contemplating the question of what I would put into the cultural literacy,
and
I think that for me, having grown up in Texas and also having kind of transplanted to the Northeast, I think that for me, one of the biggest things is understanding the history and legacy of the Black church and a lot of the conversations that I've had in the different spaces that I've navigated. So that will be my nomination. but my question is that, given the changes that we've seen in the last 30 years in terms of establishing this cultural literacy in an evolving environment, what are some of the things that you would be surprised to see 30 years from now, or wouldn't be surprised to see 30 years from now?
That's good. Alyssa, why don't you start?
Oh, gosh. I mean, certainly one of the challenges that I face as a critic is just the constant churn of what's relevant. And so trying to take sort of a long view and think about what will actually last is part of my job. And it's a difficult part of my job, in part because it determines what I jump in on at all. I think we'll, something like social networking will remain a relevant concept, whether any of the specific services that are so prevalent today are something that everyone needs to know about. I wouldn't be surprised to see Twitter and Snapchat and a bunch of other comparable services just sort of fall out of both use and knowledge. I think there's a chance Facebook will be around in 30 years, but I am not a technologist, so just that disclaimer. Let's see. It's an interesting question. It's something I really struggle with just to determine what's lasting right now. Are you looking for specific concepts, artists?
Concepts.
Sure. I mean, I would say social networking is something that I think has been, you know, obviously part of sort of sociology and political theory for a long time, but that has become relevant to everyday life now and that will continue to be important 30 years from now. I guess that would be my pick.
Can I just say a word on this question? Actually, it's to your prior point before your question. So fluency in the traditions of the Black church, I would agree, and B, I think that's a great example of a larger point about when we think about things that we might want to add or put in our top 10 list. One of the things, we didn't talk about today so much, multiculturalism, right? Which was, of course, the object of debate when this book first came out. And there was this sort of false choice made between, you know, traditional or monoculture versus multiculturalism, right? And like many dichotomies, it's deeply unsatisfying. But the way out is something actually that maybe Ethelbert Miller had first connected me to, the work of Albert Murray, African-American cultural critic writing a lot in the 70s, who wrote about omniculturalism, right? That it's certainly not about worshiping an inherited culture only that had been created by whites and mainly white men, and nor is it about imagining some realm in which you have lots of little separate pots of culture, multiples sitting next to each other, but not necessarily connecting with one another. That there is an omnivorous way in which we as Americans live, which is about hybrids and fusions. And so the Black church is not just of interest to the Black church, right? The folkways, the language, the sorrow songs, the traditions of the Black church are woven into every aspect of American life. They're woven into our literature, into our politics, into our popular culture. When President Obama speaks at the church in Charleston after the shootings and killings there and starts spontaneously singing Amazing Grace, I mean, that's multi-layered, and how you read that text of that moment and with what kind of full Americanness you can read that text depends in part on whether you've had some passing acquaintance with the Black church, right? And so I think it's a great example of this larger effort to think of ourselves in an omnicultural way.
Good word.
Great. Back to this side of the room.
Rob here, and state your name. Remember, some of you have gotten away with not stating your name. That's quite okay.
Behind the pillar.
Oh, okay. Okay.
So my name is Rob Stein. Okay. I'm having difficulty formulating this question, but because I know Eric, I have great faith that he'll reframe it so everybody can understand it. So I want to test a proposition about the validity and value of expanding this conversation from essentially frames and disciplines around social and political science to the human sciences. And so let me just make this comment, and then I think you understand the reason I'm interested in that formulation. So I know very few people in this room. And I have very little doubt that we have extraordinary differences of all sorts, including political and perceptual and cultural and all sorts of things. But I'm equally sanguine that our biology, our chemistry, our neuroscience, our anatomy, our anthropology suggest powerful similarities, commonalities, our common humanity. And as long as we frame this conversation in social science and political science, there is a tendency, I think, appropriate tendency, not a bad tendency, but appropriate tendency to focus on differences and rights and how I need to understand better the next person, all of which is absolutely true if we're going to have a commonality. But it is equally valid, it seems to me, that our commonalities, our common humanity, is precisely the deeper meaning of all are created equal. That is the call of our Constitution and of our founding. And so understanding better our commonality, isn't that part of this conversation, and doesn't it need to be elevated?
Mike, can I just say a brief word on that, and then maybe because we're getting over time.
Oh, we're over time.
We should just show folks what the top items are on the crowdsource list and invite any. The only thing I would say, Rob, is I think it is absolutely true that, you know, ultimately what we're going for is illuminating our common bonds. I think as both a practical matter and certainly in American life, but probably true in human life generally, the way you get to the universal is through the particular. Right? And so, you know, it is far, if I read a story about someone who lives in a world or from a culture that is completely unlike my own, and as I read that story, and it can be a true story in the newspaper or it can be a fictional story in a novel, and I start understanding that world that person lives in, it's through that exercise that those universal bonds of biology and heart and mind and soul begin to rise to the surface, right? If I go the other direction and just try to assert that kind of a priori, that come on, we're all humans, like, yeah, that's true, but it doesn't get through the thing that people have to get through first, right?
And I mean, certainly as a cultural critic, there's a lot of joy and fascination and variety to be lost in asserting the general over the particular. I don't know if anyone here has ever bought a copy of Peter Spear's People for their children, but he's a phenomenal children's book author, and People is his illustrated, I think completely wordless book, sort of about the world that shows people in their variety in the same situations all around the world. If you have young children, it's a must buy. All Peter Spear in general, not to go back to my 8-year-old children's book expertise, but as much as I think there's something unifying and wonderful in asserting our common humanity, just for sheer fascination, we lose a lot by suggesting that we're all the same.
Shall we look at the list now?
Let's I didn't realize we were over. So this list is the harvest thus far. crowdsourced submissions of people's top 10 items. And as we pull that up and put that on the screen, oh, there it is.
There it is. Surprised? Anybody surprised to see? Any comments? Just toss out comments, folks. Just see what surprises you, what doesn't.
The point that I think is worth making is how much stuff is under each one. Mm-hmm. So in order to understand Reconstruction, well, now you need to understand,
you need to understand the Civil War, and you need to, you know, I mean, there's a lot under each thing.
And so for purposes of our little exercise here, we've made a list, but your point is profoundly right, that our belief in this project is that to make a new updated version of this exercise, it's less about a list than it is a web, right? It is a web of concepts, and you can either literally or figuratively imagine hyperlinking everything on that list, and you click on Reconstruction and you get to questions of disunion and nullification and to the Civil War, and you click on nullification and you get to John Calhoun, and you get to John Calhoun and you get to, you know, debates today, about whether buildings should be named after him, and you get to these webbed approach to things that mimic how the brain actually works and that are made possible in ways by technology that weren't possible when Don first wrote the book and made the first version of the list.
I want to make a point, but I think that I would just guess that about 90% of those terms are in cultural literacy in that list.
Probably.
I don't know.
No?
I'm not sure about that.
None of them?
No, I'm sure some of them are, sure.
Some of them are, but I don't know.
Declaration of Independence.
Why don't we check?
So let's close, Mike, with this invitation. Yeah. If we can throw back up on the screen. So this is the list you're seeing is from a website we've just launched for this project today, which is simply whateveryamericanshouldknow.org. Whateveryamericanshouldknow.org. And we invite you to think about this, to make this a dinner table conversation or a conversation at your house of worship this weekend, whatever it might be, or on the soccer fields, and talk about what do you think ought to be on a list like this. And then just come to this website and submit your 10. Submit several lists of 10.
Oh, dear.
We're inviting folks to do this in a way that's going
your
to
hands will be fast
spark wider conversation.
I think it would be interesting if you knew whether this item was coming from the right or the left.
I think
that would be more fascinating than just the list, because I was trying to determine that as I was reading through them. Was this coming from somebody who had a conservative point of view or a liberal point of view?
Well, let's continue this conversation about the list and the project, but let me just, in closing, thank all of you for coming to the Aspen Institute today for this gathering, this conversation. Thank Mike Tomasky, our moderator, for framing up such a great discussion here. And then our thanks as well to Alyssa Rosenberg of the Washington Post and Professor Edie Hirsch, Don Hirsch from the University of Virginia. Thank you all for being here.
And thank you very much.